Live, Love, Survive, and Thrive with Rhonda Sciortino and my awesome co-host, Jenny Christiansen, certified life coach and 25-year educator. And we're so excited today to have Amber Jewell, former foster kid, foster and adoptive mom, social worker, and to have Debbie Ausburn. Let's see, it's a long list. Foster mom, former social worker, probation officer, prosecutor of crimes against children, and now defender of child welfare organizations and the good people who take care of kids. Did I cover it all?
You covered the high points, yes.
Good enough?
Okay. Good enough.
And specialist in raising other people's kids. How about that?
There we go.
I like that one. All right. So today we're going to talk about taking care of ourselves during tough times. We're in a tough time right now. Our nation is in a tough time right now. But you know, the reality is that it's not the first tough time for all of us, and it probably won't be the last. There are challenges that we face throughout our life, and we can emerge successfully from them, or we can let them roll over us like a wave and drown us. And we're not about to let that happen. So I would love to hear from all of these amazing women what their tips are for helping us survive and thrive. So Amber, Ms. Social Worker, I want to start with you. What do you think we can do to take care of ourselves? And it's not, let me just preface, it's not a selfish thing. We have to take care of ourselves, or else we're not going to be able to take care of the people within our influence, the life assignment that we have. So what do we do? Amber, take it away.
Well, I don't know if there's always a quick fix or a quick answer. So Debbie or Jenny or anybody can chime in as they come up with that, because it's individual, I think, to each of us. The biggest thing I say is some people are like, oh, self-care, that's conceited or self-indulged, or I don't have time for it. And nowadays, people and youth in particular, but really all of us, our concentration time is about 9 to 12 minutes without being distracted. And so if you are able to really want to make an influence on other people, you need to do it and touch them by your behavior and what you role model more than what you just speak and say. So how do you do that? Is you care for yourself, is role modeling what that you want them to care for themselves. And I think of that with kids, with spouses, with our co-employers, whatever, that really role modeling the ability to set boundaries yourself, set limits, say yes, say no, do all those things. You're really teaching a lot of things to others by providing that self-care. And it equips you to do awesome things for others, just like the other two ladies and all of us here in this group do, because that's how we're able to effectively do what we are called to do, by being able to equip ourselves with the skills to do that. Miss Debbie, you had a big list of responsibilities on there. And I know as a social worker, people look at me all the time and say, wow, you're really busy. Thanks for all you do. And I'm like, I also have to take care of myself. So you could relate to that.
Well, it is. Yeah, the thing that I keep going back to is every time I get on the airplane, they always, when they go through the safety thing, they always say, if the oxygen mask dropped down from the ceiling, put your own oxygen mask on first before helping anyone else. And I think that's what self-care is about. It is making sure that I have the resources to get through my very long list of things. And of course, that we'll get into it later. Sometimes tearing down the list is the first thing you need to do. But I think you're right. The first step is giving yourself permission. And it's not a matter of indulging yourself. It's just a matter of making sure I have the resources to get to my top priority.
You know, I think also in resonating with what you ladies are saying, I think we have to ask ourselves a question. You know, as a life coach, I ask powerful questions, and I ask myself questions just like I ask my clients. And I think right now there's so many things that feel and are out of control for us. You know, we cannot control the virus. You know, we cannot control the outcome, you know, and recognizing that we can't control those things. And then we have all the feelings, the things that we allow to happen. So as I look at self-care, I agree with both of you wholeheartedly. It is not selfish. It's key. It's critical. It's absolutely necessary. So I would begin to have people ask the question, what do I have the power to do right now? What do I have the power to do right now? I think that's a very powerful question, because I think we inherently want to control things, and in doing so, we neglect to care for ourselves. Would you ladies agree with that?
Oh, yes. Yeah. It's not that I'm a control freak or anything, it's very hard for me to say, you know, I just can't get that done. And because I want to do everything that's on my list. I want to take care of all of these people that are in my life, whether it's my family or my clients. And of course, I always need more clients, because more clients means more money, which gives me more resources. And So there's just a never-ending list of things that I'm supposed to take care of, by accepting that client relationship, the family relationship, my dog, whatever you call it, I feel responsible for doing it all. And that's a big part of understanding I cannot control it all. It's hard to admit that, but it's important to admit that.
I love that you just said, Debbie, because I think a lot of us are ultra responsible, and we have really good work ethic. And then if you add determination on top of that, and tenacity, and a desire to help people and to do good in the world, then it's almost impossible to say no. And
well, it is, yeah.
Somebody
and there is this sense of, if I just get the right pieces in place, I can accomplish anything.
That's right.
I
and
can
everything.
Do it all and everything.
Yes. And if I, for me, I think about, okay, if I can use technology that will automatically do some of the things that take up time, I don't ever think, oh, that'll give me a minute to sit down. No, I think that'll give me 10 extra minutes that I can write a blog, or that I can put in a conference call, and that, you know, I can catch up with so-and-so. I might be able to send a birthday card to somebody. I mean, I won't just have those 10 minutes like I can just sit and breathe. Oh, no, I'll just slide something right into that 10-minute little block in my, so it's a good combination of characteristics to have, but terrible for self-care.
And it's such a challenge, and I hear that in your voice even, Rhonda, just really having to sit down and make a cognitive choice and just taking that stop moment and making a literal, sometimes verbal choice in our minds and in our lives that says, I'm going to invest in me for a minute so that I can do all these wonderful things. And take for a second, Debbie, all the things you listed of all these things that you want to do. I could see your heart like filling up your little square there, because you know Zooms are square. I could just see your heart blooming there, and your heart and compassion to help other people and do things for other people. I will not change the perspective that for us to really give full quality of what we're meant to give other people, we have to do the same to ourselves, because we are role modeling that, but we are also equipping ourselves with the skills to give to those other people. So maybe at the top of your list, you need to write your name, because you're on your own list. I am a list maker, and put your name on your list. And it sometimes I think we think self-care is supposed to be 30 minutes or an hour or expensive. It's not that. It could be your 5 minutes of drinking your coffee and humor, Jenny. Yeah. It could be that 5 delegated minutes to you. Really important.
And I think another aspect also is, what gear are you operating in? You know, I talk about that with my clients, is are you operating, like Rhonda was saying, when we want to do all these things, sometimes we're operating in a really high gear and it's very difficult to come down to a middle ground. Or we might be operating in a very low gear and we're not taking care of ourselves. We're not seeing that anymore, or we're working so hard that we're not. So finding that place in the middle where we do take care of ourselves and find just that comfortable gear where everything just kind of has a nice rhythm to it. I think, and that applies to self-care. When we're operating on too high of a gear, that is the thing that will suffer, is taking care of ourselves.
You know, yesterday, yesterday in our conversation with David Wick, the president of the National Association of Elementary School Principals, one of the things that he said that really stuck with me was something, it had to do with, you know, kids getting their education at home, but he said, build in a brain break. And I went, ding, 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 ding. I need to build in a brain break for me. I just need to sit and not have anything on the agenda. Even when I just sit quietly, I listen to a podcast, or I have the Bible app, and you know, I'll just, you know, go on there and okay, it reads the Bible to me. I love that. I just am sitting there like a noodle and it just reads to me, but still I'm doing something, right? I'm taking something in. It's really not a brain break. It's hard for me. It feels like a complete dereliction of my duty as a human on earth to just sit and do nothing. And
oh yeah, it's hard. I realized that. My husband pointed this out on Sunday. We were doing Zoom to our church, and he was sitting there paying attention, and I was in the room and I was listening, but I was, you know, decluttering shelves, and then I sat down and I thought something else that needed to be done. And I realized it's because in his mind he was in the church service. In my mind, I was watching TV. My brain had switched to that, I am watching TV, therefore, I have to be productive while I'm watching TV.
Yes.
And do X, Y, Z things.
Yes, I totally get that. I know for a fact, I've been that way literally my whole life.
Yes.
As a little girl, I learned how to knit and crochet. And if the TV was on, I picked up my knitting and crocheting. And then it was needlepoint, and then it was something else. Even now, the idea of just sitting like a blob and just looking, staring at the box, I can't, I just can't, I don't know, there's, I can't do it.
It does get hard.
And Rhonda, I think some of what you might be talking about is a type of self-care, of meditation and something of that sort, where people are actually, that is their self-care behavior specific. But I'm a lot like you as a social worker. You know, we're busybodies typically, and we go. And self-care is very individual for who you are as a person, what your character, what your personality is. It's unique to each of us what our self-care is. Sometimes we get stressed over, and sometimes I get stressed over having self-care because of how high my expectations are of self-care, okay?
But I don't want to make your own self-care is probably not right. Right? Am I getting the point?
Well, creating your own self-care, it might be knitting. Knitting would be something I would put probably on somebody's self-care list. Not mine, because I can't see how to put anything in a needle, but on yours, it might be in your self-care. What is it when, I'm sure we've all had, if you're a driver, you've had this experience where you're driving along and you look up and all of a sudden, whoa, how did I just get here? I don't remember that road. And it's just been a daze, like you're going home or you've been on that road many times. Yeah. When you are able to do something where you reflect back and that has been your moment, that might be something that's good for your self-care. Because your brain's not spinning and going, your heart's not high-paced, your blood pressure's not heavy. You are content in you, in the path you are going right then.
Hmm. Oh, that's really good. So my time when my Bible app just reads the Bible to me, that's okay.
If that works for you. For me, my self-care is shortening my list of things to do. And that can be either I delegate it, which we can talk about. Delegating for me is very important self-care. Or I just look at the list and say, I'm not going to get to that, and that's okay. Mm-hmm. It's just off my list until I have like a little app that I can say, oh, another month. I'm gonna move the deadline out a month. Mm-hmm. And it just... It makes me feel nice when I have a shorter list. Again, something my brain does. But once I learn to give myself permission to just take things off my list and say, can't get to that, that for me, that's a very important form of self-care.
That's really
for people who are really scheduled like that, a lister, Debbie, sometimes we have to cover our paper, our list, and only have the top three things showing on our list.
Ooh, that's
kind of... taking that power back to ourselves to be able to know who we are and how our personalities are, and then set some limits for ourselves.
Right.
I say that because I'm a lister and I do that too.
And for me, it's been very important because now that I'm working from home, I have not only my emails coming in from work and my questions from my clients and my normal stuff, but I'm at the house and I see that the trash has not been taken out and it bugs me. Whereas when I'm at my office and I don't see the trash, it's not on my list. I don't think about it. It's not taking up any of my resources. So there's a lot more stuff from home taking up my resources now, my attention, my time, my emotional energy, than when I, than the days when I'm working from an office and not seeing it.
Yeah. For me, it's the laundry. Well, and everything else. I think, oh, look, that needs to be painted. Yeah. I can hear that pile of laundry, the darks laying in there. Just, they're calling my name. I don't know if you could hear it. I hear it loudly. It's getting louder. And so, in the midst of whatever it is I'm doing, I think, what harm is it? I can throw in a load of wash right there. It's nothing extra. And while I'm working, let me just have 17 things going. And then just like this morning, I go in to put my cup with a little bit of milk in the microwave before I get my coffee. And I open up the microwave to find the bowl of broccoli that I put in there last night about 5:30, because I was just going to warm up that broccoli and eat that broccoli. And there it sat all night long. So it was one of the 17 things that I had going on. Something always falls off the radar screen. And I don't know if you remember the Ed Sullivan Show. You're probably all too young for that. But I remember somebody with real long sticks, and they would balance plates on sticks. And the guy would get 20 sticks going, and all the plates are, okay, that's me. Every day, no matter what, I've got 22 plates on sticks. And sometimes the plates just fly off and crash. Hopefully they don't hit somebody in the face, but that was that bowl of broccoli I found this morning. That was just, it was a plate on a stick. I didn't even know it crashed.
Well, and for me, it's not in addition, it is doggone it, that kid knew they were supposed to take the broccoli out of the refrigerator last night. Why the heck are they leaving it there? So it's the additional family conflict kind of stuff that now is going on because someone I delegated it to didn't do what they were supposed to do, and now I have to deal with it, and, you know, there we go down that rabbit hole, and which I get, and I have learned sometimes when I delegate things, I just have to let go of them. And you know, somewhat if the trash doesn't get taken out, it is not the end of the world. And then maybe this is the point where I can tell my really, really quick story about how to delegate things. One of the issues that I discovered since being at home, we have a 17-year-old girl that we're raising now. And, over the years with foster kids, I have in the category of pick your battles. I don't worry about what the room looks like. Everybody needs a place to go to, and so I try to stay out of their room. But they can't have food in their room because of all the issues. So, of course, you get kids who that is the one rule that they decide they're going to transgress. And so we get the issues. You know, we go down that issue of, why are you in my room? Well, if you didn't have food in your room, I wouldn't be in there, and blah, blah, blah. So since I've been home, that's another one of those issues that has been right in my face, and it, you know, it was a point of conflict. And in addition, we have a beagle who would go into the room, and somehow it became our responsibility to keep the beagle out of her room. And in the course of discussing this, my husband and I, we had this epiphany of, like, she shouldn't have food in her room that attracts beagles, and certainly she shouldn't have food in her room that attracts four-footed mammals at all. And A, and B, why is it our job to keep the beagle out of her room when she's got food in there? And it kind of morphed into, the way I tell it now, is we sat down and said, look, I am not going to inspect your room anymore. It's fine. You can keep food in your room. But the beagle has every right to get into your room. She is going to be inspecting your room for food from now on. And it's between you and her, whether or not you have food in the room. And it just removed a source of conflict. Now, I can trust the beagle to search for food in somebody's room. That I have no problem delegating that. In fact, as my husband and I said to you, why were we doing the inspecting anyway when we've got a beagle who could do it? But it so far, the last 3 weeks, it has just magically removed the source of conflict. I'm out of the issue. It's between her and the beagle. So
that is so clever.
It's desperation. Desperation leads to creativity. And life has been much easier. So, you know,
natural consequences.
Yes, natural consequences. And I mean, she can't argue when the beagle thinks there's food in her room. But she says, she can say, why don't you trust me? And you know, go down that whole rabbit hole. With all I have to do with her now is say, sorry, it's between you and Sadie. She thinks there's food in your room. I don't know why. So that's why I joke. I have offloaded some of my parenting responsibilities to family dogs. And life is much better now.
Yeah. Well, I want to hear more. I want to hear some advice from our life coach and our social worker here about delegating and that kind of thing. Because I used to be really good at it, but I had my company and I had staff. So I felt like I paid people to do certain things. So I was fine with delegating. And if I'd done a good job of hiring the right person, I really didn't have to do very much about checking up to make sure that what I delegated got done and all those kinds of things. Well, now I'm looking around and it's just my husband and I and the little rat terrier Lucky that we adopted. There's just like, you know, he resists being delegated to. when we met, we were both the CEOs of our individual companies. So we were both in charge, large and in charge, and delegating. And then we come home and, you know, we both want to be in charge. So I now have, you know, 30 years of marriage to this man or whatever. And I just don't delegate at all. I just figure, I'm not even going to bother, because if I want it done, I'm going to just have to do it myself, because I don't have any staff anymore. And by the time it would, in the time it would take me to explain to Nick what I wanted him to do, I could have just done it myself. He could actually say the same thing, because he fixes everything. I call him the fixer. You know, for him to try to explain to me how to fix the garbage disposal, you know, it's the same thing. It's not a slam on him. You know, he would have it done four times by the time he would, you know, even explain to me what kind of wrench I'm supposed to be using or whatever. So there's nobody to delegate to. I want to delegate, but I have this long, long list, and it's hard for me to get anything off of the list because everything is profound and world-changing in my head. So what do I do, ladies? Let me start with our resident life coach.
Well, you know, I think delegation, I think that's a great book title, Debbie, Just Leave It to the Beagle. Everyone would want to pick up Leave It to the Beagle. I love creativity, and that's how I think. But, you know, I think delegation, particularly when we can't get it done, you know, or we feel that we can't, like in Debbie's case, there is a real seriousness to that, because what Debbie actually did in self-caring, she disconnected herself from the importance of her and her husband going in the room to check the child's room for food. And she found a replacement, which happens to be a four-legged mammal, as she said. And so I think, you know, oftentimes we have to do a disconnect to what is really, you know, what is really important. Like Amber was saying, you know, you have this litany of things to do. What are the top three things? Disconnect from the other 12 for now. You know, I mean, unless it's a, you know, something that you absolutely have to go do, a doctor's appointment or something. I think sometimes we need to understand that the power of disconnecting can be really powerful. For example, during this time of the virus or whatever, if it does not do you well to self-care by watching the news, disconnecting puts you in a place of self-care and peace. If social media is something, you could do the opposite. You know, if social media is something that brings you down, you want to disconnect from that. You know, if there is, you know, what you're feeling, your, you know, the feelings that you're, you know, the person that you're becoming during the virus, or being crabby or whatever, we have to learn to disconnect from that and connect to something that's going to make us happy, you know, and bring joy to us. So, you know, in the realm of self-care, I think sometimes we have to disconnect and prioritize. I don't mean don't ever do it, but I'm thinking that we need to get in focus the things that are really important. So what Debbie shared was really powerful, because it disconnected Debbie from that obligation, and literally the dog took over the job. I love that. What do you think, Amber?
I agree 100%. And I think the way that you're saying disconnect, I say as saying no and saying yes, because. Like when you say no, and be confident in that. You don't need necessarily an explanation. I actually did a whole Hope project day on saying no to stuff. But when you say yes, make sure there's a yes and a because. And the reason for the because is it helps us refocus on what we are investing in that time. Where's our commitment, our love, our compassion, our motivation for that? Because it reminds us a little bit of why we're doing what we're doing as well. I absolutely, there were so many different things that she said in her story that I think could be little factors. I mean, she found a person that she supported to talk to. That's a big part of self-care, is finding your person or your people that you talk to. She used humor in it. She decided, is this gonna hurt myself or anybody else if I do something or don't? And she designated no. Your broccoli, Rhonda, is that going to hurt anybody? Is it not? Can you laugh about it? I never want to lose the impact of laughter when we come and talk about self-care. Laughter, there is scientific and clinical research and research and research about the power of laughter because of what it does in our brain and our bodies and the relaxation of it. So I brought, because this is on Zoom, so can you tell what this is?
Oh my.
Yes. Would you like for me to open it? I know right now they would love this. Okay. What were you all thinking?
It's a sample of a little stool that's brown.
So why do I do that? Is think about for just this half a second how somebody feels when they smile, when they giggle, when they laugh, and being able to put that in your self-care every day, first thing in the morning, before you go to bed, hopefully during the day if you're able, but at least being able to greet the day with that self-care approach. Simple, not financially a struggle, because a lot of times we have that in families who are maybe at risk or struggling. You know, they need self-care too.
That's right.
So that's important.
More so.
That's what was so powerful, Amber, as you said, connect to humor. You know, putting in that funny, you know, comedian that you love, or connecting to great music, connecting. And again, self-care looks different for everybody. You know, you're connecting. So when you're disconnecting from that which doesn't bring you life, you're connecting to something that does bring you life. So some person, it might be sitting there in silence and just resting or taking a nap. In Rhonda's case, connecting to scripture and having that read to her. So our process of connecting is very different. But the fact is, we want to connect to something that gives us life. You know, for me, I'm very connected to a few people in my life, people who I can talk to, people who I can give burdens to, or they can give wisdom to me. So I make a concerted effort in self-care to connect to people. I don't want to be alone and isolated when I'm feeling like I need to take care of myself. So I connect to that. I try to continue to be grateful, especially in a time like this with all that's going on in the world. You know, gratitude is a buzzword everywhere. People are writing about it. People are talking about it. When we lose the power of gratitude, we are definitely not self-caring, you know, because when we're grateful, we, that is caring for ourselves. You know, the fact that we're waking up, you know, in the morning and we have another day ahead of us and we're one day closer, like Rhonda said, one day closer to an answer to the virus. Let's be grateful for that. That's important. And for me, I love to learn something new. You know, I think it's very powerful to read books and hear from people, connecting to people that get me inspired. I might not be doing what they're doing, but I want to learn something new and research. I study a lot about dementia and Alzheimer's. I was touched personally by a family member in that area. And they talk about prevention of brain, you know, issues, and all of that has a lot to do with learning something new. So if you want to self-care, you learn something new.
Well, that's really good. I reached up and grabbed my gratitude journal. A friend had this made for me, Rhonda Sciortino, Book of Gratitude. I just love this. And it really and truly does change my perspective when I just really, you know, let myself go there about what I have to be grateful for. When I'm feeling stressed out or like I haven't done enough, I'm not good enough, I'm not making a big enough impact, I'm not helping enough people, and everybody's different, whatever it is, you know, that people think about that stress them out, they're not meeting the expectations of others, whatever it is that we have to really think about, you know, that we have to have self-care for. So I guess it's different for everybody, but it really is extremely helpful. I love the laughter. I do that. I have my go-to things that just never ever fail to crack me up. As a matter of fact, the exact same episode of Seinfeld that cracked me up 20 years ago, I can watch it. I know exactly what they're going to say. I have most of the lines memorized. I'm still laughing. I don't know what that says about me, but there's a lot of things. I can watch the I Love Lucy where she and Ethel are, you know, with the candy in the box. I'm still going to laugh. I've been laughing my whole life. That was recorded before I was born. I'm still laughing. So humor, I think, is really good. And then the gratitude, absolutely.
And you know what's great about that, Rhonda, with what you're sharing there is be gentle with yourself. We need to be gentle with ourselves because that is self-care right there. If it's something, remember I said, if you're driving down the street and you don't have to focus, but you're just enjoying that drive, if you're watching that Love You, Lucy, and it's playing in your mind, you're just enjoying the moment, that is a self-care. Even if you are a multitasker naturally, that is a type of self-care. Oh, that's and when you talk about positive statements to yourself or negative, really we function in a negative driven world that we have to put that protective factor up to not sit and engulf in that. So for every negative that we hear, we should reinforce that with three positives.
Oh.
To really be able to challenge our minds. I know in school we do some journals of the what you're talking about, Jenny, and our students get really challenged to start talking about what they're grateful for, but also teaching them to do some positives for every negative, three positives, so that we can reinforce that, not only of what we do and give to others, but also of the value of ourselves.
That's really good. I think about, I can't think and write in my gratitude journal without feeling for other people. And I don't know if that's if that happens with kids. It seems to me, I don't know if I'm ready to make this be a blanket statement, but when I write in my gratitude journal, I feel like it develops empathy in me. Because if I write that I am so grateful that I can see, I have my eyesight, I automatically feel for people who don't, you know? If I'm writing, thank God that I can walk, you know, I can walk, I'm ambulatory, and there are people who are not. And it just, it. So I don't know if that's a common thing, but I automatically go to the flip side of what would life be like for me if I couldn't see. I wouldn't be able to drive a car, so I would lose a certain amount of independence. If I couldn't walk, I'm depending on other people. Oh, you know, I don't want to be dependent on anybody. And so it develops empathy in me. So I think there's a multifaceted thing that happens there.
Well, and empathy is a big part of resiliency, and there's research and theories on resiliency. And one of the big part of showing self-sufficiency and resiliency is being able to compose empathy to others and being able to have empathy for others. So that's a great characteristic about you. One thing just in the general population that I would say to that I think everybody would agree with is even those of us who are empathetic, and sometimes we can be extra empathetic, and then we struggle pulling back to that self-care. I may be maybe one of those. I don't, probably. And we have to remember that we are entitled to our own emotions and feelings, and our power and strength comes from how we react to them and how we use those. That really gives us the okay with that. It's okay however you feel about the COVID, because I see all ends of the spectrum. What's really in our power is how we react with that, and how we take care of ourselves and those emotions that we do have. And just like Debbie was talking about, the emotion and reaction to the kiddo and being tolerant and limiting how she was gonna let it affect her. And Jenny, I know you've talked to me about so many skills just even for me. So I think it's wonderful.
That's really
figuring out how to let it, how it's controlling how it affects you. It's a skill, just like anything else. It's not something that I can say today I'm going to do it, and therefore I can start doing it. You just have to take a few laps and develop the muscle. It's a matter of muscle memory as much as the analogy is muscle memory. So again, don't beat yourself up if you can't do it right away, but you learn it by doing it.
That's good. Well, this has been awesome. I think we've even actually gone over our time, but I feel like I could just sit and chat with you ladies for hours and hours, and I'm grateful for it. I'm grateful for each of you sharing today. Any last thoughts before we sign off?
Take care of yourself first so you can take care of others.
Very good. All right. All right. Well, ladies, thank you so much, and we'll do this again soon.
Take care.
Yeah.